and good afternoon. Thank you very much to ADI Japan and Alzheimer's Disease International for inviting us here today. It's a great honour and a great privilege. I have a belief that there's a systemic and gross underestimation of the capacity of people with dementia, even in the later stages of the disease. I have a unique set of eyes on dementia. I worked as a nurse in a dementia unit. I was a family care partner for two people who died from dementia, and I lived with dementia myself. I'm one of more than 50 million people in the world with dementia. I'm one of the lucky ones who's been diagnosed, apparently not 50 million diagnosed. But people with dementia are individually and collectively demanding a human rights-based approach to dementia. I'd like to acknowledge the advocates, the people with dementia that led the way. They may not have used the language of human rights or the Convention of the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, but they demanded their full rights to be included in civil society, Article 19 of the CRPD. Those people who've spurred me to take on this work, the late Dr. Richard Taylor from America, the late leader Ashley from the UK, a number of advocates who've been living with dementia, one who's joining us at some time this conference, Christine Bryden, who's been living with dementia for over 20 years, Jeannie Lee from Honolulu, Carol Mulliken from the USA. We have some wonderful, very active advocates with us here, Chris Roberts and his wife Jane, Gina Shaw, some Aussies, Glenda and John, and a few others. And one in particular who's with us this weekend or this week is James McClure, who was probably the original advocate, certainly in Scotland. Thank you for leading the way. So people with dementia are becoming very active. Christine Bryden and others were involved in setting up a group for people with dementia and care partners as far back as the year 2000. The Scottish people set up a Scottish Dementia Working Group in 2002. America set up an early onset dementia working group in 2006. Europe followed in 2012. Australia, Ireland, Japan followed in 2013. Kyama, a regional dementia advisory group. We had Dennis Frost speaking at the symposium the other day on dementia-friendly communities. There's a local group, Ontario, has taken on a lot of human rights work as well. There's a Highlands working group. There's a deep think tank in the UK. There's a small equivalent of a working group in Queensland. And I believe that England, Northern Ireland and Wales are setting up a dementia working group, launching that in May. And I've just spent some time in Taiwan and hope to help them set up a dementia working group as well. So as you can see, people with dementia around the world are speaking up about living well with dementia. I'll just give you a very brief overview of Dementia Alliance International and our collective advocacy. We had 8 founding members, 3 who have since passed away, none of them from dementia, interestingly. But from 4 different countries. We've got John Sandron here today. I apologise for the quality of that photograph, John. We are a global advocacy and support group established on the 1st of January 2014. We're run by people with dementia, for people with dementia. We've become the global voice of and advocating for the needs of people with dementia. We now represent more than 3,500 members in 39 countries and are a registered charity in the USA, thanks to the generosity of Dr. Richard Taylor before he died. We are in a strategic but autonomous partnership with ADI, also our major sponsor. So we signed a memorandum of understanding in 2015 with them, and we are at this conference are signing another one. So we're thrilled to be in partnership. We work separately and sometimes collaboratively on joint projects. not very different to ADI's vision and global charter. But people with dementia believe the only way to ensure that we can live beyond dementia is through a human rights-based approach, by supporting us to live with dementia, not only to die from it. That's a simple, basic human right. In the same way, if we were diagnosed with cancer, we would be offered some hope and some treatment. So in 2015, currently at that time as co-chair for Dementia Alliance International, I went to Geneva and spoke at the first ministerial conference on dementia and put those 3 points into my presentation, and rehabilitation and human rights and focusing on care as much as cure in research were added into the final call to action from that conference. That same year, the World Health Organization published their own documents on the need for a human rights-based approach to dementia. I won't read that out, the slides will be available afterwards. In 2016, the World Dementia Council included 2 people with dementia. Hilary Doxford from the United Kingdom and myself are both on that council. Hilary was the first member invited to join in 2015. And you can see by some of the people at this conference, it's a very much a global group now, the World Dementia Council, with countries like Nigeria, Indonesia, India, and Taiwan have representatives there. So DAI and our ADI worked collaboratively more than 12 months ago on a briefing paper to present to the ADI Council members at the meeting in Budapest prior to the conference there last year. At that council meeting, the members voted unanimously for a human rights-based approach to dementia. Professor Peter Hitler, then our human rights advisor, is now our human rights ambassador, gave a leading-edge keynote presentation on the importance of a human rights-based approach to dementia. And I think he changed a lot of minds about why we need it. And ADI also ran a human rights workshop last year in Budapest. In May of the same year, we published a small publication, Human Rights of People Living with Dementia, From Rhetoric to Reality, and we have some copies of that here in Japanese. Although we didn't print it correctly, we started in the English way of printing. The front is at the front instead of the back. But Peter Hitler said at the time, what matters to us now is that people living with dementia should be empowered to use their undisputed right of access to this and to other relevant UN human rights conventions, including the CRPD and the future convention on the rights of older persons. And we know that our world is aging, so we need to think about that. So that's the cover of our human rights publication. We thought we'd been working hard, but actually our work had just begun. In June, we had representation at the UN Conference of State Parties in New York. In August, DAI and ADI jointly presented a paper at the World Health Organization on access to the CRPD and SDGs by persons with dementia. In September, DAI had virtual attendance at the second CBR World Conference in Kuala Lumpur with a video presentation and a publication extending CBR to older persons, the global imperative. In September, we've been working behind the scenes with International Disability Alliance, and we worked very hard and now have observer member status with IDA. In October, we formally responded to the WHO Draft Zero Global Action Plan. In October, we attended the UN Human Rights Council Social Forum for the 10th anniversary of the Convention on Rights of Persons with Disabilities. And I also attended the MH Gap Forum at WHO. So that's just a few of the things we got up to last year. But it continues. I don't think we knew what we started. From October to February this year, we worked with the quality rights team at the World Health Organization on their quality rights training module. I attended the Rehabilitation 2030, the Call for Action in Geneva. I also attended the World Dementia Council meeting in Paris that same month. I presented on at the International Women's Day event held by GARA in London in March. Phyllis Ferrer, who is Vice Chair and Founder of the Ontario Dementia Working Group, attended the 17th session of the CRPD Committee in Geneva. In May, we will attend the World Health Assembly. In April, ADI and DAI have worked together. Commissioner Peter Mittler and Dr. Nicole Batch is here at this conference to prepare a joint paper to present to the ADI Council members in Kyoto. There is a briefing session about this for Alzheimer's Association on Saturday morning. So if you like getting up early, as Mark Morgan and I did today, for a 5:30 a.m. webinar online, we'll see you at breakfast. In June, we will send representatives to New York again, and I've already got an invitation to attend the MH Gap Forum in Geneva. And I'm sure there'll be many other things to do. Many have worked before DAI on human rights, and many are working after us. I think Scotland probably led the way on human rights for people with dementia. They've had the panel principles on their website for a long time. Their Charter of Rights was published in 2009, so quite a long time ago. Not too long after DAI published its booklet, the Deep Think Tank, or Innovations in Dementia, collectively published a very good book on our dementia, our rights, and I know Bruce and Jane Roberts were involved in that. But you may be wondering why people with dementia have even felt the need to work so hard for a human rights-based approach to dementia. On December 10, 1948, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was adopted by the General Assembly of the United Nations. The Convention was and still is meant to protect every single member of civil society, including people with dementia. 67 years later, however, in 2015, the OECD report addressing dementia, the OECD response concluded that dementia receives the worst care in the developed world. I live in a rich country, so I'm starting to wonder why that is, and I think we need a thinking outside the box approach to dementia, not just because of the numbers of people that we expect to be diagnosed with dementia, but how we manage that. So people with dementia are really excited that countries are now working towards human rights becoming a reality for people. Last year in Budapest, I think it was 168 countries that ratified the CRPD. We're now up to 172 countries, and countries are actively working on taking it beyond rhetoric. We're very excited about that. A disability expert last year, I quote from Neil Crowther, harnessing the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities to improve the lives of persons with dementia. It will improve our lives. I'll just very briefly talk about prescribed disengagement, because this is what happened to me, and this is what I hear from my DAI members is still happening to them. We get a diagnosis that takes a long time for many. We get told to get our end of life affairs in order and to get acquainted with needing care. See, I was a nurse, and it's the only illness I know of where people are just told to go home and give up. The cost of that is hopelessness for those of us diagnosed, and hopelessness for our families. It promotes learned helplessness, and it can mean that our care partner takes over from us, further disabling us. But why are we still being prescribed this engagement? In the 1970s, when I started nursing, so that gives you a little bit of an idea of my age, patients were diagnosed much later in the disease process. And so late stage management was completely appropriate. They did need to get their end of life affairs in order or think about their end of life, and they did need care. But the global community, the research and the clinical community has been pushing very hard for earlier or more timely diagnosis for people, but are still prescribing late stage disease management. And that, I think that really needs to change. So the current pathway promotes dependence. Forget about the human cost of that, because it's a huge human cost to be told to go home and give up and get ready to die. From an economic perspective, we can't afford had talked about the economics of that earlier, and I think that's why we need to think outside the box. So if we can treat the symptoms of dementia as disabilities and support people to maintain independence for longer, it's not necessarily a cure for dementia, but support us to maintain living independently for longer. There has to be an economic benefit to that, and there's a massive well-being benefit to that. That was the difference for me. I was at a university studying, and the university saw me as a student with disabilities who wanted to continue studying rather than a person with dementia go home and get ready to die. So through the support of my university, I managed to see dementia very differently. So we offer people wheelchair ramps and wheelchairs. We need to have support for people with dementia to maintain independence. So people with dementia borrowed the nothing about us without us from the disability movement. We've added in the nothing about us without all of us, because it does involve all of us. It's not just people with dementia that dementia affects. It affects our families. For younger people, it affects our children. My children felt the same stigma that I felt. My parents, in their late 70s and now in their 80s, felt stigma worse than I felt, because it's more stigmatised in the older generation. So we need to start to see the person, not the disease, not the deficits. So what Dementia Alliance International is, in reality, it's an online global advocacy and support group. It's free membership with free services. We have support groups in a number of different time zones. We have 24-hour-a-day open chat rooms. We can provide people who don't speak English with the platform to be able to have their own support groups in their own language. We have online webinars, and this morning at 5:30 a.m. Mr. Mark Portman, who spoke earlier, very generously got up early and did a presentation to DII members and some other people who couldn't be here about his time with ADI. So we took this conference out to the community through the website. The internet's been amazing for people with dementia. We have monthly, often educational webinars with very eminent international speakers. We run masterclasses occasionally. That's a picture of Chris Roberts, actually, with one of our t-shirts. We see ourselves as the dementia experts of the lived experience, because it's only if you're diagnosed with dementia that you really know what it's like to live with it. It's only if you've lost memories or forgotten a person's face or can't work out how to drive the car. It's only if those things happen to you that you know how it feels. I think I've got an old set of slides here, because I do have some slides that I was going to talk about driving. A colleague of mine in Japan had asked me to talk about driving, and I don't think the new slides have been uploaded. So do you mind if I just read from my notes? So if you're diagnosed with dementia in Japan, the driver's licenses are denied or revoked for people with dementia, apparently straight away. These blanket measures offer no consideration for individual differences or abilities or personalities. And some people with dementia have very poor memories in general, but can still remember things like traffic signals and the road regulations. In countries such as Australia, Canada, Singapore, the UK and Norway, people with dementia are assessed before their driving license is taken away. So I don't personally believe that driving is a human right, but your system should at least allow you to sit a driving test before they just blatantly take away your driving license. So I thought I was safe to drive. I had my driver's license taken away about 7 or 8 years ago. I thought I was safe to drive. My doctors thought I was safe to drive, and I failed my driving test miserably. So I suspect that people with dementia don't don't have quite as much insight about their own capacity to thrive, but just to have it taken away with no assessment is actually also a human rights issue. Oh, so tomorrow, no, this afternoon at 2 o'clock, DAI is running a 90-minute workshop called Diagnosed with Dementia, What Next? And we're going to have a number of people living with dementia and their care partner or family member tell their stories, and then we're going to talk about what next, what people with dementia want after their diagnosis. So we'd love to see some of you there. We intend to engage with the United Nations Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, including through its policy-making processes. We will seek to further develop productive relationships with the global network of NH rights institutions. We will continue to work together with ADI to prepare and disseminate widely information to our members and to ADI Council members on the rights of persons with dementia and how to effectively use that legislation. And we encourage and support national, regional organisations and countries to participate in the examinations by the UN Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities of their own states. And we highly recommend countries writing national dementia strategies. So my recommendation from a human rights perspective is that people with dementia have a human right to a timely diagnosis. We have a human right to a human rights-based approach to diagnosis of dementia and then our care, which includes proactive rehabilitation, not necessarily for cure, but for well-being and quality of life, and disability support. Both of those things improve our resilience, our hope, our quality of life, and keep us independent for longer. And then when we require it, we have a human right to palliative care. People with dementia would like to see, and it was fantastic to hear Jeremy Hughes from Alzheimer's Society UK talk about the initiative in the UK. There's much more balanced research now. It's not just research for a cure, but also research for risk reduction, prevention, and for care, both for the person diagnosed with dementia and their families. And I think in people with younger onset dementia, the cohort that's really missed out on care currently has been our children. So I was thrilled last night to meet a young woman from Indonesia who set up some kind of online support network for young carers. I would love to hear you presenting sometime. And then like Faisal said, education, education, education. I don't want staff coming to my home who are nurses or carers who know nothing about dementia. I have a human right to have staff who know what dementia is and how to help me live with it. I need doctors well trained in dementia as well. We all do. That's a basic human right. Thanks to my UK publisher, I did publish a book in 2016 last year, and I now have a Japanese version of it, which is very exciting. And I'm going to be at the Create Kamigawa booth at 1 o'clock this afternoon if anyone wants to come and meet me there. And I know there's lots of people with dementia here. I met quite a few of you last night. And thanks to this dementia, I've got a little koala for all the people with dementia. So come up and see me. I want to give you your little koala from Australia. There is also a chapter on human rights in my book.